It's the end of the week. Time to kick off your heels, grab a handful of nuts, and treat yourself to bubbles and gossip. From Club Eagle Amsterdam, this is Nikki Today Tonight.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Nikki Today Tonight. Oh, wow. It's going to be Christmas soon, I noticed.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, it's have you already got...
like Christmas.
Yeah, definitely. Have you already gotten your Christmas tree ready?
Well, yes.
Yeah?
Yeah?
Yeah. And it's also the International Day to End Violence Against Sex Workers. Very important indeed. Yeah. Yeah, you could actually be a sex worker. Oh, my God. Oh, the echo. Oh, my God. I'd turn into a sex worker, too.
Yeah. Well, you look like one now. Sorry.
I look like a hooker.
You look stunning. Yeah. Absolutely fabulous.
I thought I'd dress a little bit more Christmassy.
Yeah, you
with
look like
Christmas
a Christmas ball,
days coming.
Yeah.
A Christmas ball.
Yeah.
No, I'm not a Christmas ball. You're a Christmas ball. I am a peak.
Yeah,
I don't know what they what would they call that in
English? I don't
know
what it is in English.
I don't know. We've got a fabulous show coming up. We've got great guests, including actually a premiere for the Netherlands, right?
Oh, yes.
And the rest of mainland Europe. It's going to be special today.
Oh yeah!
But let's check out who are going to be the guests for this evening.
In this week's Nikki Today Tonight. Chelsea boy goes gaga in the night. T.O.'s Mr. Leather Netherlands 2022. Adam experienced a real-life miracle. And for Rens, it's all just child's play. Isn't that exciting?
And here she is, the wonderful Chelsea boy! Come on down, sweetheart. Stunning.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's a bit like, it's a little bit Nina Hagen.
Hello,
yeah.
Thank you very much.
It's great. I got some bubbles for you, sweetheart.
Thank you so much, darling. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, that would be nice.
I love your hair. You look incredible.
Thank you. Well, you look incredible. Let's continue. You look incredible.
You look incredible, bitch.
Cheers, sweetheart.
Oh, you both look incredible. Cheers. Yeah.
Yeah. Cheers, sweetie. Oh, so how are you? How has, has this COVID enduring COVID pandemic been treating you?
I am doing well. It's been, of course, an interesting year. And I think for me, it's gone like all over the place. It's gone up and down. And I think it's taught me a lot of things. It's been a year of great heights and of great lows as well. And right now I'm in a phase where I'm getting ready for the new season. And I'm very excited.
Great. You know who I'm also excited about? Our next guest. He is Mr. Leather's, Mr. Leather Netherlands 2022. And here he is, T.O. Lelyveld. Come on down, sweetheart.
Well, hello.
Yourself some bubbles.
Oh yes, I love it. Yeah. Thank you.
And then when you get seated, take off your masks.
Yes.
So we can see your beautiful smile.
Oh, yeah.
Hi. A little bit more to come a little bit closer. You
yes,
can be a little
course.
Bit closer.
Yes.
Yeah, that's it. So how are you, sweetheart?
I'm great. Thank you very much for having me here. I'm doing really great. Thank you.
So you're the new Mr. Leather.
Yes. Who had thought that 2 years ago? Yes. I'm. I've been elected a month ago here in the Eagle, and I'm very proud of it.
Great.
Yeah.
So, Chelsea boy, let's
yes,
go
darling.
Back to you. So you were in season one of Drag Race Holland, right?
Oh, yes.
And that was kind of a bit of pioneering for mainstream the Netherlands and Benelux and stuff like that. But at the same time, you were actually pioneering within the pioneering because you do drag, you see drag as, well, as an art form that goes every way, every sideways. And it's not just all about, you know, a guy dressing up as a girl. You embraced the other side. Why did you, how did you get there?
So for me, I think I played for a very long time. I played within the box of the female impersonation. That's how I started drag. That's how I did drag for about 5-6 years. And at one point, I started to feel limited, and I started to feel that for me, it wasn't complete. There was something missing. So I quit for a while to just reflect and to just see, you know, what exactly it was that was missing. And I noticed that this box that I created for myself was too limiting, and there's so much more outside of this identification of a woman, and we can create creatures and aliens and fantasy characters, and I felt myself drawn to that, and that's when I started, you know, to explore that more. And I think on Drag Race, what was challenging for me, like you're saying, I was pioneering, what was challenging for me was to stay true to myself, but not get kicked out on the first episode, if that makes sense. Because of course there's a format that you kind of expected to stick to, but I wanted to kind of bend the rules within the format, and I think I succeeded in that, and I'm very happy with the whole experience, and I gained 9 lovely new sisters. So it has been absolutely wonderful experience.
Do you realize that you were pioneering, actually being a role model for everyone, or just notice it later on?
I know I do something different within drag, and I'm aware of my position there. What I did not know is that there's so many kids out there that are really, you know, drawn to somebody that does something completely different in this way, and all the love I've received since has been just overwhelming.
You celebrate all kinds of drag. How did Chelsea Boy come about? I mean, you started off as a lady impersonator. I also know that you have a very famous mum who's been in my show before.
Snorella, yes.
So how did that happen? How did you become Chelsea Boy?
I think Chelsea Boy came around when I started investigating different sides of my identity, and I wanted to portray a character that really represents who I am as a person. And nowadays, Chelsea Boy really grew into a character that I really use as an instrument to really navigate through life, basically. It's like a magnifying glass, almost. Like, if I have a question about life or something I don't understand, I just throw it in my drag and just see what happens, you know? Kind of like Chelsea Boy's playing the strings on the guitar of my life, kind of thing. So it's just been mostly fun, and I'm not identifying with Chelsea Boy as myself. It's a character that I created to just play around and to show people different sides of life.
I know that you sing.
Yes.
There are not many drag queens that sing, right?
There's a couple, and I believe there's a new show that just got aired.
True, yeah, yeah.
With singing drag queens.
But we are known for...
Lip syncing, which is something that I did for years. And lip syncing is an art that I respect very much. There's
Definitely.
Not a whole lot of queens that can do a proper lip sync.
I know.
The way it's done, convince the audience that you're the one singing the song. That's the drag queen's job. And it's something that I respect very much. I look at, for example, Vanessa Van Cartier.
Yeah, she's
just this is like subliminal, like every little breath and, you know, every moment of the song, she delivers it properly. And but for me, I've always loved singing, and for some reason I don't connect to lip syncing as much. And when I get on stage, I just love to throw it all out there.
And you're going to throw it all out here in a couple of minutes. We're going to see a great performance by you. But we'll get back to you later. First, we're going to go to your neighbor. Hello.
Hello.
Mr. Leather Netherlands 2022 is also going to be 2023, 2024.
I hope not. I hope I managed with 1 year. My former Mr. Leather had 2 years because of the pandemic. And I hope I can put everything in 1 year.
Because you just were, it was also here, right?
Yes, right on this spot.
Yeah.
Great.
You got the chance to become, and how did you become Miss Leather? Why did you choose to do that?
Well, first of all, because it's fun. And I'm a person who likes to wear leather, but also in generally. So on the street, in the trains. And the letter community is based around Amsterdam. And I'm from Brabant, from Den Bosch.
The south of the Netherlands.
And there are also very much letter guys and letter boys and letter women. And I thought, well, let's bring some of the country into the city. And I thought, well, maybe that's the best way to do that is to become Mr. Letter himself. And, well, I got to be that. And I'm
Why do you think that you won?
Why? Well, it's about I can bring something. I have done already some socials in Brabant, and I'm known. And
what are socials?
Fetish social. So everybody who has a fetish and wants to meet people, then they come to us, and it's.
It's like a little party just for the.
It's a sort of party, but it's more like to talk with each other and to get to know different people who have the same fetish. And
we drags don't do that, do we?
You just go through.
We should start a drag social.
Yeah, that sounds like a lovely plan.
Yeah, we can talk.
I already love to combine drag with rubber and leather.
It would be
so
great.
Why not?
I saw lots of drags with real great rubber on. So, and well, it can also be a fetish. And well, we have to stand with each other, and it's all about communicating with each other and seeing each other.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, what do you hope to bring this year to the title?
I hope. And that's also a little bit with the pandemic. I hope I can bring people together, and especially now when there are a few parts of thoughts, everybody has their opinion. And I hope that I can bring people together and not to have the opinion makes their lives. It's just an opinion. And just see each other for who they are and not from what their opinion is. And I want to bring letter to the people, also the straight people, the people at home with their dinners, and just go there and say, hi, I'm Theo, I'm a letter guy, and I'm not very strange.
What will be the biggest thing that you will hope to achieve besides bringing people together for you personally?
I hope, to be as a gay guy, as a letter guy, and as a person who has HIV, to be accepted for just myself. 5 years ago, I was just Theo. I'm still Theo, only I got some baggage with me. So that's the most important
thing. But everyone has baggage, and you've got a train to carry the baggage for you.
Sweetie. Yes, yes.
And a community.
Yeah, and a real great community.
Yeah. And speaking of community, you are singing a song by somebody who's very big for our community, isn't you?
Yes.
So what song are you going to do?
I'm going to sing Marry the Night by Lady Gaga, which is one of my favorites from her. And apparently this month, it's the 10-year anniversary of the song as well. Which
I know. I can't wait to listen to it.
I'm very excited. Thank you so much.
So
see you in a bit.
I will announce you. So here is Chelsea Boy with Marry the Night.
I'm gonna marry the night. I won't give up on my life. I'm a warrior queen, live passionately tonight. I'm gonna marry the dark. Gonna make love to the star. I'm a soldier to my own emptiness. I'm a winner. I'm gonna marry the night. I'm gonna marry the night. I'm gonna marry the night. I'm not gonna cry anymore. I'm gonna marry the night. Leave nothing on these streets to explore. Mama, ma, marry. Mama, ma, marry. Mama, ma, marry the night. lace up my boots, throw on some leather and cruise down the street that I love in my fishnet gloves. I'm a sinner. Then I'll go down to the bar, but I won't cry anymore. I hold my whiskey up high, kiss the bartender twice. I'm a loser. I'm gonna marry the night. I'm gonna marry the night. I'm gonna marry the night. I'm not gonna cry anymore. I'm gonna marry the night. Leave nothing on these streets to explore. Mama Mary, Mama Mary, Mama Mary the night. Mama Mary, Mama Mary, Mama Mary the night. Nothing's too cool to take me from you. New York is not just a tan that you'll never lose. Love is the new denim all black, skeleton guns and wedding bells in the attic. Get ginger ready, Clyde Bell coming no front. Won't poke holes in the seats with my heels, cause that's where we make love. Come on and run. Turn the car on and run. I'm gonna marry the night. I'm not gonna cry anymore. Streets to explore. Mama Mary, Mama Mary, Mama Mary the night. Mama Mary, Mama Mary, Mama Mary the night. Mama Mary, Mama Mary, Mama Mary the night. Mama Mary, Mama marry the night. I'm gonna marry the night. Won't give up on my life.
That was wonderful. That was wonderful. Now we're gonna go to our next guest. He is, he's someone very special.
Yes, he is.
It is Adam Castillejo. Hello, sweetheart. Come on down. How are you? Sit down. Grab yourself some bubbles.
Thank you.
So,
cheers.
Yeah, we should. Cheers.
Cheers.
So, how are you, sweetheart?
I'm really good. I'm really glad to be here tonight, and so glad you invite me.
Of course.
It's an honor for me to be here tonight.
Well, it's an honor for me to have you here as well. I mean, you've got quite a story to tell. We're going to listen to it later, but let's get the other guest down as well.
Yeah.
He is a friend of mine. He is into something that people might think a little bit awkward, but I think it's fabulous. He is Rens de Jonge! Hello, sweetheart, how are you? Oh, you're so adorable. Sit down. Oh, wow.
I love your outfits.
I love it.
I love it.
And what's his name?
Bear.
Bear, okay. And the other bear's name?
Bear. No.
Bear two. Bear one, bear two. So how are you, sweetie?
I'm doing very well. It's almost Christmas
time. Oh, you want
some
bubbles too?
Later, maybe.
You're later, okay. No. Oh, he's not allowed to drink.
Yeah.
It's for 18 plus, isn't it?
So how are you, sweetheart?
I'm doing so well. It's almost Christmas time and always cheers me up. And this year is a little bit quiet, of course, with the whole corona thing as well. And that reduces some stress as well, so it's more time to enjoy the Christmas vibe. I'm doing very well.
Okay, great. Well, we're going to go to Adam. Adam, I met you a couple of weeks ago,
yeah,
and we hit it off straight away. And the great thing is that you are you're a very open person, but there's something very special about you that a lot of people don't know.
Yeah.
You are what they call the London patient.
Yeah.
Could you explain us what the London patient is?
The London patient is the second man to be cured of HIV. And that is an honor and privilege to be there.
The second man cured of HIV.
It's a very humble place to be.
How did that happen?
And it's a long story, and it happened in 2015 when I was diagnosed terminally ill, and my only chance of survival was I had a bone marrow transplant.
Okay, well, you were diagnosed with
cancer. First of all, I'm a cancer survivor. It's important to tell people, first of all, that. And in 2015, I was...
And by that time, you already had HIV, right?
Yes, I had HIV since 2003, so it's been a long time. And it was it's terrifying to be there, but at the same time, I had this amazing opportunity by my doctors to able to achieve something amazing, to be cured of my cancer and my HIV. That it was like, boom.
What happened?
Me.
I mean, that means, wow. I mean, let's go back to that moment. I mean, you get a call, you're saying, well, we're going to do a bone marrow transplant.
Yeah.
That's, you're like, wow, finally, something's going to do something for my cancer.
For my cancer.
And then they said.
And the doctor said, oh, I have got another news for you. And he said, I think we may can cure your HIV. And I were like, and it took a few seconds for me to understand. I was like rolling.
I think I need a whole week.
No, I think it took a while. I mean, I remember, as I say, I was on a double-decker bus in the UK, in London, and I remember hanging up the call and smiling and saying, I won the lottery. That's what the first thing I said to myself. Oh, wow. Because I never thought in my lifetime I will see HIV cure. For me, it's very important to have responsibility to the science. Because at the same time, I didn't want to fail. You know, people say to me, why you fail? So I was afraid to fail to the community because I want to be cured not only for me, for our community. So I was on pressure, but I felt like I didn't want to fail on that.
And then the procedure happened?
Yes.
And when was the moment that you realized that you were actually cured? I mean, it's
unbelievable.
It's still unbelievable for me to say that out loud, that somebody's been cured of HIV. Mm. Wow.
It took a few years. It took time. I think by 2017, I had my transplant in 2016. By 2017, when I decided to take medication because that was a big step. And I did something very important to me. Like on my birthday, I decided to stop medication. And I say, what else can I give to myself important and people can relate to me in the future to stop HIV medication on my birthday? So I did that in 2017. And the first time I remember with the doctors, we have the HIV test, we call negative. We have big smile on our face, like, wow, I'm less again not too excited because we might not be cured. So, and then happened 6 months, 12 months, and 18 months, they say, well, Adam, now your journey will begin now. Let's talk about what names we want to use, UK patient, the British patient.
You told me that was something that touched me a lot, is that you celebrate two birthdays.
Yes, I think that people really don't know. When you have a transplant, the day you were in the UK especially, I don't know if it related to anywhere in the world, maybe in here in Holland, but in the UK, when you have a transplant, the day you're going to have a transplant, they give you a car. It has a big zero on it. And they say, you nurse and doctor, here you are, your life starts today. It's your day zero. And that it was a powerful moment for me because to realize my life star again. So now I have two birthdays.
So how old are you now?
I'm 6 years old.
6 years old. Just like your name.
So there you go.
Was it a risky operation?
It was very risky. It was very intense. I think I people contact me, like you ask me, I say, I will not recommend to anybody. First of all, you have to have cancer to have this.
Yeah.
And I don't wish to anybody like that. However, some people in our community has ask, can I have it? And say, no, you cannot, because you have to have cancer first to be able to have it. So
you have a new lease on life.
Yeah.
I know that you do a lot for the community. But you actually, that was so funny, that story. He told me we went to a hospital, you came there, and there was this one little nurse standing in the back, all giddy and happy that you were there because you were donating your blood.
Yeah, I think I gave a big surprise today. I think I went to the Rotterdam University, you know, the hospital, and I had all the research, HIV research, for the cure, and I had all this young energy because you can feel the energy on these scientists. And I said, you know, thank you for having me today, and I want to do something wonderful for you to donate blood. And you can see, as I say, that emotion they have, and that, because that's what I'm here, that's what I'm the London patient. I want to give hope, and if I can help in any way, I want to give back to our community.
Is that what you do in every country? Go there and donate your blood?
No, I wish I could, but it's not, because our laws in many countries, we are not allowed to donate because we are HIV. It's important, people don't realize I'm still part of our HIV community. I always will be part of our HIV community, no matter what.
Do you get people who don't think that you are
part of it? Yes, a lot of people say, no, you're not part of us anymore. I said, no, I'm still part of the HIV community. I will always be an HIV man. I'm cured, but I always will be a part of the HIV community.
Yeah. What are your future goals? What would you like to do for your personal and your life journey?
Yeah, Adam and the London patient is one person, and it's just me. And what I want for the future is to create a London Patient Foundation to raise awareness only about cancer, about HIV and mental health. And that is why I call myself Ambassador of Hope, because I want to give hope not only to our HIV community, to our cancer community, and because after all, we all suffer some part of the life for mental health, and we don't talk about a lot of that. So I think that's what I call myself Ambassador Hope. That's the future for me.
Wow. This is such an inspiring story. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And next to you is somebody else who he reads stories.
Yeah, bedtime stories.
Bedtime stories.
No, he has them read for him. Yes. That's a different thing.
So, Jens, you have a little fetish, we
I
call
do.
It, yeah?
Yes.
So, we can all guess what, right? You're into age
play. I
have
no idea.
So could you tell people what age play is?
Yeah, Nikki. So very simply, age play is when people role play to be of a different age than they really are. And in the context that we're talking about it now, it's usually people pretending to be kids. And that can be very young kids, or it can be like teenagers or anything. And when people role play like that, that's basically already what we call age play. So when we think...
It's actually like acting.
Yeah, but it's even not that specific necessarily. I think if we think of how many people sleep with stuffed animals at night because it makes them feel warm and protected and like basically nostalgic, that's also, I think, a little bit of age play going on. There's a lot of age play going on everywhere.
Really? Yeah. Oh yeah, when you feel very...
I'm 6 years old, so...
Yeah. Yes, you know what it's like.
He's a six-year-old pretending to be a grown man. Yeah.
That's the other way around, isn't it? Yeah.
Is it sexual?
For me, you mean?
Yeah.
For me, it is partially sexual and partially not.
Could you be more specific?
Yes. Yeah. So for me, I grew up with a fetish, and I was very acutely aware that I had a fetish, and I found myself very weird because of it. And it really defined my teenage years, I think, this insecurity that I had with this fetish that I was carrying as a weight on my back, really. And as I grew older and became an adult, I started to explore the world and find people who were also into this kind of thing and also had similar fetishes. And I found out that there was a community centered around these different fetishes that people actually find each other for understanding and for having a place where these things are normal. And that suddenly opened up the door for me to start exploring myself in ways that I really hadn't thought of before. And my personality completely changed, and the way I look at relationships completely changed, and those are not really part of sexuality anymore for me. So that's what I mean when I say it's sexual and also not sexual.
Do you have... Are you bisexual, gay, hetero?
I'm mostly straight, maybe bisexual-ish.
Okay. So... do you also search that in a partner, that partner is also into age play, and that maybe a mummy.
Are you looking for a daddy?
Or a mummy or a daddy?
I'm not applying, but...
Yeah, okay. Well, I do mostly confine myself to people who at least kind of have a connection with this. So I don't necessarily look for people who are like, who totally want to be my mommy or daddy or something, but at least I need to be able to have this part of me be like outspoken and welcome with them, you know?
Okay. So, do you also get really weird reactions? I can imagine that.
I do, yes. There are weird questions you get sometimes. Of course, like when people are very not familiar with this, you get weird looks. And people sometimes have suspicions that you're like masking pedophilia or something.
Okay.
Or like promoting pedophilia, that sort of thing. Those are, I think, the kind of things you get more when you don't really get a good opportunity to present yourself. So when people see me in real life, I don't really get that very often. But maybe when people come across this online or something and they can get like a glimpse of it, but not a full idea of what it is, that sort of misconception can take place, and it happens a lot, yeah.
And what does that do with you?
I think that's part of where the insecurity has come from when I was a teenager. And I think that's where a lot of insecurity for people all over the world comes from. When they are ashamed of being themselves as an age player. Yeah, there's a lot of misconceptions that are very damaging.
I can imagine that. Is it only age play that you are into, or are more things that you like to do?
Well, I'm very kinky in general. So, yes, that's maybe not representative of all age players.
You look so innocent.
Could you give a little bit of detail of what would happen when you start your age play?
Together with someone,
yeah,
you mean?
Yeah, with somebody.
Okay.
How would that go?
Yeah, okay, so in a dynamic like that, you often have someone, like, which would be me in that regard usually, who is the child and one who is the parent or the caregiver in that regard. And that really means that it's a power transfer. You give control to someone else and they make
decisions.
It's a bit
like S&M.
It's very much like S&M and like dominance and submission and slaves
but
and monsters.
But then cuter. But
then cuter, really, yeah, that's it.
Like, in the kindergarten.
That's exactly it. That's okay. How I like to explain it too to people. Like, if you are kinky, you might already understand the basics of what's going on here. It's not that difficult when you get a little bit of
No, it's not that difficult to understand. No. Oh, it's actually... I'll read you a bedtime story.
I'm looking forward to it, yes.
So much.
You've done worse.
I need to learn more about this. I'm 6 years old after all.
So what do you hope to accomplish? I mean, you're sitting here right now pretty open about it. I mean, that's very vulnerable. What do you hope to accomplish?
Yeah, so there's not a rich history of people being very open about this. I think that's very recent that you see people being a little bit more open.
Because you've been on TV.
I've been on TV, last week.
And did a couple of chat shows.
That was really a transformation for me as well. It was really a big step because indeed I felt vulnerable doing that. But now that I like made that step, and also I was already being a bit more visible because I was organizing things in the community a little bit and trying to be like a bit of an ambassador in the first place, that I was already kind of making that step. And now that I'm like really over the threshold and there's really no going back, I feel like I can maybe just go for it. You know, I try and make the world a better place for age players by talking about it to people and presenting us as not that scary and not harmful and definitely not weird to be around.
Well, you're not scary at all, darling.
Thank you.
And do you want to play a game?
Definitely.
Yeah. Do you want to play a game? Let's play a game.
Let's do it.
So, I play with my new teddy.
I thought we'd play a little game today. It's Friday night. We'll play a little game. And it's called... do you want to do a Nicky or a Tricky? You know, I always tell the truth. I always tell the truth. That's a Nicky. And a Tricky is, well, you have to do something I tell you to do. So let's, you know, go from one to another. We start with Adam. Do you want to do a Nicky or a Tricky?
Tricky.
You want to do a Tricky. Okay. So oh my gosh. I got for you, fake your grandmother's orgasm.
Oh! I want a Nicky.
That's our way back.
Okay, if you get a point, then...
Okay.
Do we accept that? Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you want a Nicky or a
Nicky, please, yes.
Okay. So, sweetheart, what's the worst prank you ever played on someone?
Oh, the worst prank I ever played on someone? It's tough. I think I changed someone's sexual orientation on Facebook and they didn't notice for 3 years or something. That was maybe a little bit escalated prank, yes.
But maybe they just didn't want to notice it.
Yeah.
Maybe they were secretly into something. Yeah. So, let's go to you, Nicky.
Nicky
again. Who of us here would you do straight away?
My piano man.
Oh,
come here, darling.
You're into a little beard. Okay, sweetie. Nicky or Tricky?
I should do Tricky, doesn't
yeah,
I?
Yeah, do it
okay,
Tricky.
Let me give you Tricky.
Try to eat this clementine as sexy as possible.
As sexy as possible? Okay.
So let's see. You got 2 points and you got 1 point. Let's see if you can up the points.
Oh, yeah.
Score.
I'm going to do my best.
So far, it's not...
Well, this is not
Teddy's
very sexy.
Yeah,
okay, I'm doing my best, you know. Okay.
Teddy's watching you.
Teddy's watching
you,
okay.
Oh, make it as sexy as possible. Turn us on with that clementine. That's the most non-sexual food ever. Here goes. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, wow. Does it turn you on up there? Yeah, it did. We'll give him a point. Thank you, sweetheart. So, the last one, a Nicky or a Tricky?
Nicky.
A Nicky. Spit or swallow?
A bit of both.
A bit of both. It depends on what it tastes like.
Ginger ale.
Okay. So, you, Nicky or Tricky?
Give me another Nicky.
Another Nicky. Okay. What is the worst thing that you've ever put into your mouth? That's not nice.
No.
That's the worst thing I've ever put into my mouth. Okay. I remember playing a game of... taste what it is, you know, when you blindfold it, and someone put an entire stick of butter in my mouth. It was not pleasant, no.
No.
I think that should be my answer. Yes.
Okay.
Maybe not what you're looking for, I'm sorry.
Yeah, well, that's that. Okay.
We were looking for a juicier story, but we'll do.
But that's fine, okay. Well, they're both one now. They both got 3 points.
Oh, God.
So, yeah.
Just call it the tie, mate.
You know what? We'll give them a prize. You can give them a prize.
Yes.
Give them a prize. You can share it. You're breaking it in half. No, you'll get one later on. You get a signed album.
Thank you.
There you go. Both of you. So thank you so much. Thank you all my guests. A big applause for my guests up there. Chelsea Boy.
Yeah.
Thank you. And thank you, of course, Mr. Leather Netherlands, Theo Lelyveld.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. And a big thank you to Adam. And of course, Rens.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you all so much.
Thank you for watching this week's episode of Nicky Today Tonight. We'll be back next week on Christmas Eve. From us here at Club Eagle Amsterdam, and of course Dirk, I all wish you a wonderful evening. You with the sad eyes, don't be discouraged, though I realize it's hard to take courage in a world full of people. You side of it all, and the darkness inside you can make you feel so small. But I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True colors are beautiful, like a rainbow. Show me a smile and don't be unhappy. Can't remember when I last saw you laughing. If this world makes you crazy and you've taken all you can bear, just call me up, because you know I'll be there. And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True colors, true colors are shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True colors are beautiful like a rainbow.